Well, good morning, friends. It's a rainy day here on the west coast of BC, and it's time to swap out the freshwater coolant in this Yanmar 3GM FC engine. It's got a sail drive. I hope you'll come along. I plan to demonstrate some of the anatomy of the cooling system and some of the intriguing features of what makes a marine cooling system so interesting. First thing we're going to do is take the stairs out. There are two screws here, and then two more. We'll take them right out. Okay, I don't want to spend too much time on the saltwater aspect of this, but basically saltwater is drawn in from a sail drive here along this green tube to the saltwater impeller. It's a rubber impeller style pump that needs to be swapped out every once in a while. From there, the saltwater, the cold saltwater, is sent along this tube. There's no connection in the behind here, and it gets to the heat exchanger where it exchanges heat but doesn't mix with the adjacent freshwater. From there, the saltwater goes up this anti-siphon valve here, and I'll show you a better shot of that in a minute. And then from there it goes to the exhaust elbow. Now here's a better view of this anti-siphon valve right here. And you need an anti-siphon valve in these kind of boats because the motor is below the level of the water. And so water could actually siphon right into the boat and sink your boat. And so this valve needs to be present. Now you just, to take that off, you just unscrew it. So all these things are one-way valves. You can see there it is right there. And they allow air to go one way, but not the other. So if you blow on it, you can't get anything through. But if you suck on it, it acts normally. And so this one is working normally. And then have a look down the other end, make sure there's nothing stuck in it. I suppose you could probe that and make sure that it's all clear, but it looks good to me. So I'm going to briefly go through the system as to how it works here. When I use the word freshwater, I'm referring to coolant, and of course saltwater is the seawater. So the saltwater comes through here and picks up the heat from the hot freshwater coming in here. They exchange them, and then the coolant, the freshwater, comes out here nice and cold and ready to cool the engine again. It goes into the belt-driven freshwater pump. Now this pump is different than the impeller-style pump for the seawater. It's much more durable and it requires much less maintenance. From the pump, it goes along this tube here to the engine block and then up from the engine block to the head. Now, one thing I'll mention about these pumps, like water pumps in a car, these pumps have a little orifice called the weep hole, and I'm going to show you that in a second. Now, the idea behind the weep hole is that you've got fresh water on one side and you've got bearings and oil on the other, and what keeps the two apart is a seal. And that seal can degenerate and start to leak. And when it starts to leak, you'll see weeping out of the weep hole. And it's an early sign that your water pump seal is dying. And it's an early warning that if you ignore it, eventually the bearings will fail and the water pump will seize. And of course, if that happens when you're on a long trip, you're in trouble. And so if you have a problem with the weep hole, then it's time to change out that water pump. But aside from that, there's not much maintenance these things require. So I'm going to do this handheld to show you the weep hole. We're going underneath it on this side. And if you look right there, that little hole. Now I've looked closely at that. It's not leaking, but you got to be careful because the coolant may evaporate. And so you may just have a bit of crusty calcification there. I've got you back on looking at the top. Now this boat has a heater for hot water off the tap. And so that's what these two lines are here. This is the hot. So the hot water from the coolant goes to a heat exchanger in the back there, which warms up our water so we don't have to boil water all the time. And then this is the return pipe for that. But let's look at a few more normal structures. The thermostat is right back in here underneath this cover. And this is the coolant temp sensor right there. Hot coolant comes from the water jacket around the engine, goes through the engine head, and makes its way to a T-intersection at the thermostat. You see, cold friction during warm-up is a major problem. And this little T-intersection is the universal solution. When the engine is cold, the heat exchanger and its big mass of cold fluid is part of that problem. So the thermostat is designed to route the warming coolant down a bypass pathway that completely excludes the heat exchanger and all of its extra cold fluid from the system. Fluid that goes down that bypass pathway goes directly to the water pump and the engine. So this works by both avoiding contact with cold seawater and by reducing the total mass of coolant the engine needs to warm up. Old-style thermostats controlled only one side of this intersection, the gate to the thermostat, and they relied on the resistance of a smaller diameter bypass tube to limit bypass after the thermostat opened. But this little Yanmar thermostat actively controls flow down both sides.
here's a cutout diagram of the Yanmar thermostat and its housing. The T-intersection is inside of that. There's a wax pellet inside the thermostat, shown in yellow, that expands when adjacent coolant heats it up. When cold, the two springs you see close the thermostat gate at the top and open the bypass gate at the bottom. And when the pellet expands, the bypass gate closes and the thermostat gate opens. Here's a closer view. Because there are two valves, and because they can stick either open or closed, you can imagine variance in presentation depending on which valve is sticking.
Okay, now what if some of these valves failed? You might want to pause the video and think to yourself how this might present. Certainly it's very complex when the thermostat controls two separate valves. When the thermostat valve is stuck open, you end up with a slow warm-up, and if it's stuck closed, you end up with overheating. If the bypass valve is stuck open, you end up with a running temperature that's way too high because you get inefficient cooling. And if the bypass is stuck closed, you can end up with system pressures that are too high.
To verify your freshwater pump is working and the thermostat is opening, after warm-up, carefully put your hand onto the hose leading to the heat exchanger. If you have good coolant flow there, that hose should be distinctly hotter than the hose returning coolant back to the heat exchanger to the pump. If both hoses are hot, it suggests poor heat exchange, most commonly pointing to a problem on the saltwater side. If both hoses are cold, your thermostat hasn't opened.
So I've repositioned you so that you can see the heat exchanger. This is the port through which the warm coolant comes back to the heat exchanger. In the background, you can see the coolant fill bottle. And then this, you'd call this a radiator cap in a car. They call it the coolant fill cap in a marine engine. And of course, just like with a radiator in a car, you don't open this when it's hot. Now, I want you to think about this. I think that this is the genius behind the system. The design of these caps is absolutely ingenious. And I want you to think about how is it that fluid that's in that coolant reservoir, how does that fluid get with no power, no pumps, nothing, how does that fluid get into the engine? While I'm doing that, I'll just take the end off and show you that this tube actually goes down below the level of the fluid there. While you're thinking about it, I'll get this off. Now, one person asked me once, how do you get these off? You generally push down and turn. It's counterclockwise. And there we are. And this one is right at the brim, which is where you want it. Now, I'm looking very closely at the seal here. I did a whole video on the radiator cap on automobiles. And so if you're interested in more detail, you can go to that. But basically what there is here is there are two one-way spring-loaded valves. And the system is entirely driven by atmospheric pressure. Now, when the pressure in the cooling system increases, and you want it to be fairly high, somewhere in the range of 13 or 14 PSI, when that pressure rises, if it rises too high, this spring is overcome. And air or fluid goes back along this coolant recovery tube to be stored in the coolant recovery bottle. That's simple enough. But how does the fluid get back? Well, it gets back because there's a second valve underneath this little cap here. And that valve points in the opposite direction. And when pressure in the system is below atmospheric pressure, that valve pops open and coolant can go back. Now, the way that works is that when you get trapped air in the system needs to burp itself. It needs to clear that trapped air. And so when you heat the engine up, the gas inside the system expands dramatically, and that dramatically raises the pressure. And so gas escapes. But even after you shut the engine off, there's going to be gas still in there. Now, overnight, when the engine cools, the gas shrinks to such an extent that the pressure inside drops below atmospheric pressure. That opens that little valve right here to allow coolant to replace the gas that was there the day before.
So, just like a pinhole leak in the sidewall of a straw, any pinhole leak along the course of this tube or at the cap seal will mess up the vacuum needed to achieve automatic burping overnight after a hot engine cools.
Let's get going and drain the fluid. Now, there are two drains in this engine. On the starboard side, there's one drain. You can see it right there. I hope you can see it. And that drains the heat exchanger. And then there's a second drain on the port side that drains the engine block. Now, just to confuse you, they've put in a third drain here, which is a drain for the salt water, and we don't need to do anything with that today. Let me take you into the starboard side panel. Okay. This is a 12 millimeter wrench. I think it's actually SAE.
Well, when I opened this starboard valve, I was surprised not to get any coolant flow. So then I moved over to the port side to drain the lower engine block, thinking that the heat exchange reservoir would mostly drain by gravity into the block anyway. That way there'd be less mess if I removed a plugged spigot.
Now the port side block drain is down here behind the alternator. Back in there, I'm going to take you in the other side to have a closer look at it. Okay, so it's this screw right here. So I don't know if you can see it, but it is draining. So this is draining nicely, but as expected, the recovery bottle is not draining, and so I'm going to have to siphon that out directly to get the remainder of that out. And it's always nice to have a little extra length of tubing. I'm just siphoning that out of the coolant recovery bottle so I get everything out. This is a port side spigot for draining the heat exchanger, and when you undo this, it should come out through this hole. But look at this. Oh my gosh, it's just completely plugged off. To get a nail and clean that all out, but that's why it wasn't draining. Even with this out, it wasn't draining. So in any case, it didn't really matter, because when I drained the block, pretty much all the fluid that was in that heat exchanger made its way through the block drain. And now it's clearly patent, but I'm just gonna clear this up and put it back on. It should work better next time.
Some of you will notice that I've left something out, draining the heat exchanger for my potable water. Most of us don't have a spigot at the heat exchanger for draining coolant, so the standard way of replacing that volume is to remove the two hoses at the water pump here and flush the length of tubing from one end, being careful to capture all the excess coming out of the other hose into a bucket for recycling. I'm skipping that step today, but if you do it, after flushing I would refill the heat exchanger with coolant directly through one arm of the tubing to clear as much trapped air from the system as possible. Trapped air is the greatest risk of a coolant swap, and it isn't uncommon for a novice to kill an engine by incompletely refilling and then going for a sail. You may think you've refilled completely, but when you restart the engine, pockets of trapped air will migrate into the pump and cause ineffective pump performance, and then further migrate to the cylinder wall and cause superheat damage.
All right, here's what I've chosen to use. It's low silicate, low phosphate, and amine-free. Honestly, I don't think it makes much difference in this old steel engine. The literature says to use coolant that's compatible with aluminum, although there's not much aluminum in this vehicle. I'm doing about a 40% mixture more distilled water than coolant. You can buy the pre-mixed coolant as well, although it's about twice as expensive. And so what I tend to do is I tend to use either deionized water, which you can get at hardware stores, or distilled water, which you can get at places like Walmart in the food section. Now this funnel here, you'll look, it's a bit different than usual. It's called a spill-free funnel. And the idea behind it is that you get trapped air inside the system, and if you want to, you can run the engine and try and clear bubbles more effectively than otherwise. But in this little engine, I'm not sure it makes much of a difference, and my seal isn't that great. And so I'm just gonna fill it right to the top, put the cap on, run it for a bit, and we'll see what we get. The nice thing about a spill-free funnel is this part here. If it's slightly overfilled, no, it's distilled water right now. And so I just take this away.
Here I'm siphoning new diluted pink coolant into the coolant recovery bottle. You can do that with a long funnel, but there isn't much room to reach in without spilling, especially if the upper stair platform is in place. All right, here's a point of confusion. In the manual, Yanmar described engine block and engine head zincs. Indeed, these old Yanmar engines can be set up to pump lake water directly into the engine block, akin to how an outboard motor works. Of course, outboard motors can be tilted out of the water to stop galvanic reactions, except when in use. But direct cooling with seawater is rarely done in boats designed to continuously moor in salt water. Galvanic reactions are just too powerful, and the risk of pumping in debris or wildlife that might clog narrow passageways in a water jacket is just too high. Those block zincs alluded to in the Yanmar manual are for engines cooled directly by lake water. Engines that use a combination of distilled water and antifreeze, like this engine and standard cars, don't require block zincs. That's because coolant mixed with distilled water is a poor galvanic electrolyte. The saltwater side of the heat exchanger is fairly resistant to galvanic corrosion, so Yanmar chose not to put a zinc in there. This boat has both internal and external sail drive zincs that I change out every year, but no block or heat exchanger zincs. Well, once you understand the fundamentals, making diagnoses on the water is that much easier. Even so, problems on the freshwater side are an uncommon cause of overheating. It looks like I'm going to need to take off that heat exchanger in the coming weeks and flush it out, and I'll take you along for that, and hopefully we can cover some of that territory in the future. Say, I hope you find time to contribute your experience in the discussion thread. That kind of discussion makes the video that much better. Thanks for watching.